A bulletin. A United States cruiser has captured an Axis merchant vessel which was displaying American flags. The capture took place on November 6th in Atlantic equatorial waters. The Navy announces that the Axis crew tried to scuttle the merchant ship and severely damaged it. The captured vessel, first prize of the American Navy in the undeclared war on the Atlantic, is being towed to a port within the jurisdiction of an American court. This bulletin came to you from the NBC newsroom in New York.
Good evening, and welcome to the week ending November 8th, 1941. My name is Henry Chop, your host, and tonight we are going to listen to the George Burns and Gracie Allen program from November 4th, 1941. CBS's The World Today news program from November 5th, 1941. Vic and Sade also from November 5th, 1941. And a regional program called This is Wichita from November 6th, 1941. It all begins in just a little bit. As you may know, we have moved our primary operations over to Patreon, spelled P-A-T-R-E-O-N. If you would still like the daily World War II old-time radio programs, you can find us over there. The link is in the expanded description to this video. The name of the page is World War II on the air and in print, plus other stuff. To gain access to the programs, you must subscribe for free. That gets you a morning program you can listen to or even download to save if you'd like. We do have a premium tier that is subscription only for $5 a month. With that paid subscription, you will get a morning newspaper to read via clippings and any out-of-era radio programs we may decide to put up, such as radio recordings that feature music that we don't have to clip out or mute because YouTube requires us to. How cool is that? We have made this morning's newspaper public, so you can take a look and see if it's something that you might be into. Again, if you'd like a daily dose of World War II old-time radio, find us on Patreon under the title World War II on the air and in print, plus other stuff. The link is in the expanded description to this video. The basic tier is free, but you do have to subscribe to gain access. For a morning newspaper and out-of-era radio, the cost is a mere $5 a month, cheaper than some news or music apps today. We hope to see you there. Over on Patreon, we are also going through Christmas year by year. We're up to the mid-70s right now, and we will be going into the 1980s all the way up to last year with several hours of radio programs shared each day as we count up to Christmas. So check it out. I think you'll enjoy it. It's free. The first program that we are going to listen to tonight was a comedy program. It's the George Burns and Gracie Allen program. Burns and Allen started as a vaudeville act. They were married, and this is a pretty good program. The episode is titled Playing Mrs. North. It's a great comedy series. This is the first year that George Burns and Gracie Allen went from their kind of a stage show type of program to a sitcom format. As you can tell, it's still a little bit rusty, but it's still a great program. Sponsored by Swan Soap, let's give it a listen. Here's the George Burns and Gracie Allen show.
Hello. Are you there? Well, we're here.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 ways better, Swan Soap.
Yes, sir. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of Swan, the new white floating soap that's 8 ways better than all style floating soaps, presents Paul Whiteman. Your Swanee announcer, Bill Goodwin. Our singer, Jimmy Cash. Well, I swan, the stars of our show, George Burns and Gracie Allen. Yes, sir, it's the new Burns and Allen show, and now we listen in on Gracie at home.
Hello? Yes. Yeah, this is Gracie Allen. Who's this? Who? Who? Well, you have to spell it. M-O-T-H? Moth? M-O-T-H-E-R, oh, the Mother. Oh, sorry, but we have all the mothballs we need. What? M-A-M-A. Oh, hello, Mother, how are you? What? You think this is... What? Hold the phone, Mother. Jimmy Cash, please, I'm on the phone. What, Mother? No, that isn't George singing in the bathtub. No, today's Tuesday. Say, Mother, how's Bessie? What? You think Mr. Peterson the butcher is falling in love with Bessie? How do you know? Oh, last night she found a forget-me-not on her calf's liver? Oh, good. You went to the football game this Saturday. Oh, really? $4.40 a ticket? My, that's expensive. What? Papa made a touchdown. Oh, Papa made a touchdown at the Elks Club. Well, I'll have to say goodbye, Mother. What? A message for George? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, wait, I'll have to write that down. Hilda!
Yeah, Mrs. Burns?
Go in the den and get me a pencil, please. Oh, by the way, Mother, yesterday I went out in the garden and I picked the most beautiful sweet peas, but George didn't like them. Well, maybe I should have cooked them plain instead of with carrots. Oh, yeah. Well, I must tell you...
Here's your pencil. Mrs. Burns.
Oh, thanks. All right, Mother, I've got the pencil. What was that message again? Well, not so fast. Say hello to George. Oh, all right.
Oh, hello, sweetheart.
Oh, George, Mother just sent you a message. Hello.
Hello. Well, sit down, Gracie. I've got some wonderful news for you. MGM wants you to make a picture.
Really?
Yes. Mr. and Mrs. North was a big hit on Broadway last season, and now MGM wants you to be Mrs. North.
Well, I couldn't do that, George. I'm already Mrs. Burns.
I know that,
but... Oh, my mother wouldn't like it if I took a second husband.
I know that, but...
She isn't crazy about my first one.
I know that, too. Gracie, this is a wonderful opportunity for you. And another thing, it'll be a great experience. Then again, look at the practical side. Now, don't only think of yourself, think of me. Think of the money we'll make.
Oh, George, you sound just like you're proposing again.
Gracie, will you make the picture?
Certainly.
Well, Gracie, you've made me so happy that you can have anything you want.
Oh, will you give me my half of my salary?
I'm not that happy. Well, anyway, you're going to make this...
Hello, Bill.
Oh, hello, Gracie. Bill. Hello, George. Say, what's this I've been reading in Luella Parsons' column that MGM wants Gracie to do Mr. and Mrs. North?
Is it in the paper already?
Yeah.
Say, I've got one in the den. I'll take a look. Gracie. What's that?
It's Jimmy Cash. He's rehearsing here.
Oh, yeah? Well, let me listen.
Open the door. I want to see if he made it. He did.
Say, George, Mr. and Mrs. North was a Broadway play, wasn't it?
Yes.
Oh, boy, I'd like to play a part like that, Mr. North.
Do you think you can do it, Bill?
Oh, do it. There's nothing to acting. Watch, I'll be Mr. North, and Gracie, you're Mrs. North.
Oh, I just can't wait. Go ahead.
Mrs. North, darling, I've something important to tell you.
Yes? Go ahead.
Darling, did you know that Swan is the first really new white floating soap since the gay 90s? And Swan is 8 ways better than old-style floating soaps.
Oh, you say the sweetest things. Go ahead.
Why, for instance, darling, you should see the suds you get with Swan soap. Richer, longer-lasting suds. And Swan lathers twice as fast as any old-fashioned floating soap, even in the hardest water.
Oh, Mr. North, I'll bet you tell that to all the girls. Go ahead.
Mrs. North, darling, try Swan for washing your dishes. Try Swan for all your soap and water tasks. I love you, and you'll love Swan. Try Swan.
Cut. You call that acting? Why, Bill, you've got no feeling. Look, I'll show you how to do it. Ah, oh, Mrs. North, I love you. And Mrs. North, you'll love Swan. Swan, that wonderful soap. That floating soap. Just give me a cake. That white floating soap. And I'll go alone, happy, with you. And Swan.
Oh, what a ham.
He is not a ham, are you, George?
I should say not.
Oh, George, I want to thank you for that gold locket you left on the table yesterday.
A gold locket?
Yes.
What gold locket?
You know, the one that has the picture of the walrus in it.
A walrus?
Yes.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about. Anyway, I have to call up MGM and tell them that the deal is okay. Say, that's funny. There's a woman talking on the other end of the phone.
Oh, let me listen. Oh, it's my mother. She's still on the phone. I forgot to tell her to hang up. You can hang up, Mother. Goodbye.
Mr. Burns, you want to hear my song now?
Well, yeah, you can start, kid, but I've got to make a phone call. I'll be right in. Operator. Operator. Get me in.
Hasn't it all been thrilling, living from kiss to kiss? And weren't you more than willing to keep it forever like this? Wasn't it you who planned each exciting day? And didn't you lead the way? Wasn't it you who said our love would never die? Wasn't it you who planned each exciting day? We found a heaven for two, and didn't you lead the way? Wasn't it you who said our love would never die? Can it be you now saying goodbye?
Jimmy, that was swell. Now you can run back to the grocery store and close up.
Not tonight.
Oh, I bet you're going out tonight.
Yeah.
With a girl?
Yeah.
Nice?
It reminds me of my mother.
Hmm. Who is she?
My sister.
Goodbye, Jimmy.
Oh, George, did you get MGM on the phone?
Oh, yes, and Irving Asher, the producer, is coming over in 20 minutes with a contract for Gracie to sign.
Well, gee, that's wonderful, George. It sounds exciting.
Well, it is.
Imagine Jimmy Cash going out with his sister.
Gracie, I'm talking about the picture.
Oh, that's wonderful, too.
Wonderful, and what a part that Mrs. North is. She's in every scene. She talks for hours. She says the silliest, staffiest, dumbest, craziest things you ever heard in your life.
I'm not going to do it.
It's one of the greatest, the most... You're not going to do it?
No, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to get on that screen and say a lot of silly things. I want to act natural.
Act natural?
Well, certainly. I'm not going to have people laugh at me.
Look, Gracie...
It's the trouble with Hollywood. They miscast everybody. Like, I saw a picture called Tom Harmon of Michigan, all about a football player. And the fellow who played the part of Tom Harmon wasn't the type at all.
The part was played by Tom Harmon.
Oh, now you see, he got the job because he was a relative.
Gracie, I've listened to you talk for years and years, and you say less than any woman I know.
That's why I can't play the part of Mrs. North. I don't talk enough.
Hmm. That's because the days are getting shorter.
And then again, I don't believe that being quiet should be carried to extremes like some people do. Like, I met a woman at the club last week, and I chatted with her just to be polite. And all the time I was with her, she didn't even say one word. But on the other hand...
Gracie, who was this woman?
Billy Burke. But on the other hand...
Billy Burke?
Yes.
Yeah, a regular sphinx.
Oh, please, George. She's one of my dearest friends.
Gracie, this is a great part.
Not going to do it.
Hilda!
Yeah, I'm bringing the aspirin.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yes, yes. Bill, you're a smart fella. Why don't you talk to Gracie?
Because I'm a smart fella.
Thanks.
Here's the aspirin.
Oh, Hilda, how's your boyfriend, Olaf? You know, the one who always says huts, hut?
Please, Bill, now, Gracie, this is...
He's not going to do it.
Oh, I don't go around with Olaf anymore.
No?
No, you know, he was so bashful that he never even kissed me on the forehead.
Oh, well, don't let that worry you, Hilda. I went around with George for 3 years before he kissed me on the forehead. And then he went back to kissing me on the lips again.
Yeah, that's because you started wearing bangs. Anyway, listen, Gracie.
Not gonna do it.
Mrs. Burns, I'm sorry. I had an accident. I tore one of your towels in half.
Oh, well, that's all right, Hilda. You can use it like Swan soap, half in the kitchen and half in the bathroom.
Well, thanks, Gracie.
You're welcome.
Gracie, will you listen to me?
Not going to do it. So, Hilda, you gave up Olaf, huh?
Oh, yeah, I had to give him up. I couldn't understand him. He spoke with a dialect.
Well, who's your boyfriend now?
Oh, he's in the kitchen. I will call him. Come in, sweetheart.
See mi vida, que quiere mi pedazo de caramelo?
Well, that's all I needed. It's Senor Lee. You're Hilda's sweetheart?
Hutsut.
Oh, go with that Hutsut.
Senor Burns, don't be a grouch. I like to see a man with a smile on his face. In your case, I would even settle for a face.
Look, Senor Lee, Olaf happens to be Hilda's childhood sweetheart.
I have thought it all out, Senor Burns, and the voice inside of me says, Senor Lee, you are a rat if you take Hilda away from Olaf.
Well?
Squeak, squeak!
Lee, you're not the guy for Hilda. She's just a nice, plain girl.
So what? What has Hedy Lamarr got that she hasn't got?
Well, nothing.
Boy, do you need glasses.
Hilda, take him back in the kitchen. Gracie, Mrs. North is a great
Paul. I'm not going to do it. Oh, it's Paul Wagon. Hello, Paul.
Oh, hello, Paul.
Hello, everybody.
Gee, Paul, you've taken off some weight.
Yes, and I've got to take 10 more inches off my waistline.
Really? Why?
So I can get close enough to the table to reach the food.
Well, you look great, Paul. Just drag up a loading platform and sit down. Gracie, the producer is going to be here.
I'm not going to do it.
Look, honey, don't think that I'm trying to bribe you. But you know that beautiful caracal coat that we saw at Magnan's? The one you like so much?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'd like to see you buy it.
Well, then you should have been with me yesterday.
Look, Gracie, MGM doesn't offer these parts.
Not going to do
it. No, not going
to
do
it. Hey, I hate to change the tempo, but when I was here yesterday, I left a gold locket on the table. It was for Mrs. Whiteman. It's her birthday today. May I have it?
Oh, so that's the locket Gracie was talking about. Paul, was that your locket?
Yes, my picture was in it.
Oh, yes, the walrus. Gracie, where's the locket?
You mean the locket?
Yes, the locket.
You mean the gold locket?
Yeah, the gold locket. Where's the locket?
Well, you never can tell when something might be missing, and if it is, I didn't do it.
Gracie, don't...
Hey, today is my wife's birthday. Don't tell me it's lost.
Well, it isn't exactly lost. What happened was, I was sitting and knitting some backless sweaters for soldiers, and all of a sudden...
Backless sweaters?
Well, yes, they asked me to knit sweaters for the boys at the front.
What about the locket?
Well, I'm coming to that. And all of a sudden, a burglar climbed through the window.
A burglar?
Yes, the town's full of burglars. They're here for a convention, I guess.
Yes. I read about it in the papers.
You did?
Yes.
Then you believe this story?
Oh, sure I do.
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. Wait till you hear the finish. A burglar came in a half an hour ago, took the locket, hit me on the head, and I was unconscious for 5 hours.
You are, huh?
Why, Gracie, according to that story, you'd be unconscious right now.
That's right. That's why I think she's telling the truth. Gracie, where's the locket?
Oh, I'm awfully sorry, Paul. I thought George left that locket there as a surprise for me.
Well, where is it?
Well, you know that antique shop around the corner?
Yes.
I traded it in.
You traded it in?
But, Gracie, how could you think it was your locket? Didn't you see P.W. engraved on it?
Well, yeah, but, Paul, I thought the engraver had an impediment in his speech and pronounced my name Tracy Wallen.
Tracy Wallen?
Well, anyway, what did you trade the locket for? I mean the locket. What did you trade it for?
Well, I traded it in for this musical powder box. Look.
But that locket was an heirloom.
Yes, but this musical powder box is a genuine antique. It's 150 years old, and when you lift up the lid, it plays music. Listen.
Oh, Daddy. 150 years old?
Yeah, an old daddy.
An old daddy, huh? Close it.
Come on, Gracie. Let's go over to the antique shop and get my locket back.
All right, Paul. Let's go.
But, Gracie, the producer is coming with the contract.
I won't do it.
Gracie, you're staying in the house.
I won't do it.
Gracie, you're staying here.
I won't do it.
You will.
I won't.
You will.
I won't.
You will.
I won't.
You will.
I won't.
You will.
Paul Whiteman and the orchestra playing The Waltz of the Flowers.
This is great. A producer from MGM is coming to our house, and here we are in front of an antique shop.
Oh, now, boys, I better go in alone. If we all go in, he might think the locket's very valuable, and even though it's worth nothing, he might double the price. And double nothing is $64, and it's certainly not worth $64,
talking.
So
stop
I think the best
talking.
Thing for me to
stop
do is to
talking.
Go by myself.
Now go in, and if you're not out in 2 minutes, I'm coming in to get you.
All right. Now dunk away.
Oh.
How'd you do, madam? Aren't you the lady who swapped the locket for a musical powder box?
Well, yes, and I'd like to swap it back for the locket.
Oh, gladly. But can I keep the picture inside?
Do you like it?
Oh, yes. It'll make a wonderful design for a poker chip.
Oh, well, here's your powder box. Will you wrap up the locket?
Gladly.
Oh, my, you have lovely things here. Isn't this adorable? A statue of a woman with a clock in the center of a forehead.
Madam, this is an exact reproduction of Venus de Milo.
Oh, the poor thing. She has no arms. How does she keep the clock wound?
Well, I couldn't say. My partner will be back later.
Well, wrap it up.
Gladly. Well, here's your locket all wrapped up in a little box for you.
Oh, thank you.
Gladly.
Who's that?
Oh, that's my husband knocking on the window. If he thinks I'm going home to sign that movie contract, he's crazy. I'll stay here all day, even if I have to buy the whole store.
You mean you've got a chance to be a movie star and you don't want to?
I should say not. If I'm a movie star, I'd have to put my footprints in cement in front of the Chinese theater.
Well?
Well, if I got lost in the woods, then no one could find me because I wouldn't have any footprints.
Yes, I see. Well, here's your clock, madam.
Here they come.
Gracie, what's taking you so long?
Well, I just bought the prettiest clock. Here, hold it.
All right, Gracie, the producer is waiting.
I'm not going to do it. Here, George, put this little box in your pocket.
But, Gracie...
Oh, mister, what a beautiful vase.
Oh, fine.
That's an antique.
You'd never know it.
Well, the older they are, the more valuable they become.
You know, if I were you, mister, I'd get a younger clerk in here so it'll make your antiques look older.
Now, look, Gracie...
Gracie, I'd like to give that locket to my wife for her 27th birthday. And that happens to be today.
Oh, really, Paul? Well, you ought to buy her a present.
Gracie, we've got to get home.
Not going
to
do it. Hmm.
Madam, that vase you admired is a genuine Ming vase.
Ming vase. Wrap it up.
Gladly.
And Gracie. George, you'll have to buy me a coat to match it.
Oh, a Ming coat.
Yeah.
I thought so.
Oh, and my, what a beautiful antique bed. I must go over and see it.
George, You'll never get her home to sign the contract.
Well, what can I do, Bill?
You better do something. I'd like to give that locket to my wife for her 35th birthday.
Well, I'm trying to get it, but I keep getting sidetracked.
Well, don't let yourself get sidetracked. I'll show you how to get it. Watch me. Hey, mister.
Yes, sir?
Now, look, that gentleman over there happens to be Paul Whiteman.
Paul
and
Whiteman?
Yesterday,
why,
yes,
my,
and
he's
yesterday,
put on some weight, didn't he?
Anyway, this
well,
lady...
Well, you know, I've been listening to Paul Whiteman for years, and I just love him on that new radio show.
Never mind the new radio show, and never mind Paul Whiteman. This lady
is
came in...
Is it true
in...
about that soap? Does it really do all they say?
Never mind about the... Is it true?
There we go.
Why, listen, Mr. Swan is even more than they say. It's a brand new kind of white floating soap. 8 ways better than old-style floating soap.
Bill, don't get sidetracked.
Don't worry, I won't. Why, Swan is whiter. It smells fresh and clean. And Swan soap is pure and gentle, as mild as the very finest imported Castile soaps.
Oh, Bill, I just love to hear you talk, but talk slower. I'm in no hurry.
Oh, well, Swan soap is so mild, it's ideal for bathing the baby.
Bill, don't forget it's my wife's birthday.
Congratulations. And remember, each cake of Swan is really twins. Break Swan in two. Use half in the kitchen, half in your tub or shower. Try Swan. It comes in that cool-looking green wrapper with the white swan on the front. Now, you see, George, nobody sidetracks me.
I heard it. I was here all the time. Now, look, I've got to get Gracie home to sign that contract. Look, Gracie.
I'm not going to do it. What did you say that bed was?
Well, this is great.
It's genuine antique. Why, George Washington slept in this bed. And so did Thomas Jefferson. And so did James Monroe.
Who slept in the middle?
In the middle?
Wrap it up.
Gladly.
Gracie, please get that locket. I'd like to give it to my wife on her 48th birthday.
Gracie, the producer is...
I'm not going to do it, mister. What's on the third shelf?
That's dust.
Wrap it up.
Wrap it up. Quiet. Quiet. Look, mister, I've had enough of this.
Hello.
Oh, it's Elsie Myers who lives across the street from us. Hello, Elsie.
Hello, Gertrude.
My name is Gracie.
Oh, yeah, I must remember that. Say, Gracie, is that big antique moose head yours?
Yeah, we've been married for years.
I knew that barber gave me a bum haircut.
Well, I just dropped in to get an ashtray for my husband. What's his name?
Frank.
Oh, yeah, I must remember that.
Gracie, get that locket. I've got to get home with it before May Robeson leaves me.
Now, I'm going to settle this. Mister, where's that locket that my wife traded?
Well, I gave it to her a half hour ago.
You did?
Gladly.
Gracie, where's the locket?
I gave it to you. It's in your pocket.
In my pocket?
Gladly.
Gladly, look. Well, come on, let's go. Oh, here it is. Here it is, Paul.
Oh, goodbye. Oh, Elsie, you remember Bill Goodwin. You met him last week.
Oh, yes, he sells duck soup.
Swan soap.
Yeah, must remember that.
Well, come on, let's go.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, boys.
Goodbye.
Well, come on, Gracie, let's hurry home. I hope that producer is still here.
Come in, Senor Burns.
Hey, Lee, why are you opening the door? Where's Hilda?
She's upstairs putting my clothes in the guest room.
You're going to live here?
Why not? If you can stand this house, I can.
Hey, Lee, is there a man in here waiting for me?
He left a half hour ago.
I knew this was would happen now. The whole deal is probably all.
George, would you like some homemade cookies from the May Company?
No. After working for weeks trying to get you that part, and such a great part, and such a great picture, and such a great story.
Hello? Who? Yes?
Who was that?
Mr. Lasvogel.
Oh, that snoopy neighbor who's always looking in our windows. Gracie, hang up.
What? Oh, thank you very much. Goodbye. George, Mr. Lasvogel said that the man who was here smoked two of your cigars and left a note on the piano.
That guy knows everything. Always looking in our windows. Say, Gracie, look at this. Dear George, I waited as long as I could, but will be back tomorrow to have Gracie sign contract. Mrs. North will be a wonderful part for Gracie.
Not going
to
do it.
I know that it's a perfect part for her because all Gracie has to do is be herself. Sign, Irving Asher.
Be myself? Well, that's different. Now I'll do it.
I thought so, yeah.
Well, I thought they wanted me to play a dizzy dame like Betty Davis in The Little Foxes.
Betty Davis and The Little Foxes is a dizzy dame?
Well, sure. Any dame that would kill Herbert Marshall must be dizzy.
Well, I guess so. I guess so.
Remember, folks, buy Swan. Try Swan. Get Swan at your dealers today. See for yourself if Swan isn't really eight ways better than old-style floating soaps. Now, once again, George and Gracie.
Hello?
Oh, hello, Gracie. This is Mrs. Whiteman.
Ask her how she liked the locket.
How did you like the locket Paul gave you?
Well, I traded it in.
Well, I don't blame you. For what?
Listen.
Good night, folks. Good night.
The makers of Swan, the new white floating soap, join George and Gracie in inviting you to tune in again next week, same time. Until then, this is Phil Goodwin saying, well, I swan. Why don't you?
Before we get to the news on CBS and Vic and Sade, I'm going to play those two programs uninterrupted together. Let me tell you about the programs that are going to be featured this week. I'll go through Monday or Sunday through Tuesday over on Patreon. Let's see what we have going on here. Tomorrow we will spotlight November 9th, 1941 with The Shadow, NBC News, The Great Gildersleeve, The Jack Benny Program, The Screen Guild Theater, and The Columbia Workshop. On Monday, it's once again November 10th, 1941, and we will feature News, The Goldbergs, Vic and Sade, The Adventures of Superman, I Love a Mystery, The Lone Ranger, The Lux Radio Theater, Cavalcade of America, and Lum and Abner. And Tuesday, it's once again Armistice Day, now known as Veterans Day, back in 1941, November 11th. And we will have a Red Skelton Show rehearsal, an NBC news program, a news event with a convoy in the Atlantic, several political addresses for Armistice Day, including Frank Knox, Secretary of the Navy, and President Roosevelt. And we will have the Goldbergs, Mandrake the Magician, Fibber McGee and Molly, a Bob Hope rehearsal recording that runs over an hour long, and the Red Skelton program. And Lum and Abner, that Red Skelton program, by the way, is the finished product from the rehearsal program that you will be listening to in the morning, or as the first feature on that upload. So go find us on Patreon. The link is in the description section to this video. There is a lot of great programs featured on there. You'll enjoy it as we go through World War II day by day on that channel. And also for $5 extra, you can read the newspaper daily and read in detail what was going on as far as World War II or anything in the newspaper. A lot of crime news and advertisements and a lot of interesting stuff. I think you'll enjoy it. So go check us out over on Patreon. And right now, let's listen to the news and Vic and Sade, and I'll be back right after these two programs in about 30 minutes or so.
The World Today. At this time, the Columbia Broadcasting System presents a summary of all the important news in the world today. Reports from CBS correspondents in the major foreign capitals, direct by transatlantic shortwave radio, and the latest developments as received by Columbia's newsroom here in New York. Tonight, John Daly will call in Bob Trout from London for a report on the latest developments as seen in the British capital. We shall also hear from Albert Warner in Washington. And now first, John Daly.
Here is an overall glance at the main developments in the news up to airtime. The latest Russian war communique once again declares the Red Army is fighting on all fronts, that the drive on Moscow has been halted at all points, but gives no details except on the activity of the Soviet Air Force, which apparently is desperately resisting the Luftwaffe in the Moscow region. The Nazis, for their part, claim they've broken the last Russian defense line in the Crimea and assert that their troops besieging Moscow are now within 31 miles of the Soviet capital. British planes have been active most of the day over the Channel, bombing sea and land objectives. Canada's Navy Minister announced that German submarines are operating within sight of the Newfoundland coast. Two have been attacked and one possibly sunk in Belle Isle Channel. The United States and Canadian governments established a joint committee to coordinate the two countries' industries and speed up war production. In Washington, where the committee was announced, the government moved on the labor front. The War Department took over five more branch plants and two warehouses of the Air Associates Company. The OPM indicated a coming settlement of the welders' strike on the West Coast, and a presidential emergency board recommended temporary wage increases for more than 1 million railroad workers. In the Far East, it was announced that the Japanese diplomat who signed Tokyo's pact with the Axis is flying to this country in an attempt to improve relations with the United States. Those are the outstanding developments on the world scene today. Now, a fuller report on the war in Russia. The version from Berlin claims that a Nazi spearhead driving through the Ayala Mountains of the Crimea has reached the shore of the Black Sea. It's declared this movement has penetrated the last natural fortress left to the Russians in the Crimean campaign and has split the Red Army forces into three segments. It's also asserted that the Germans are now in a position to spread out along the coast and take the Soviet positions from the rear. Reports from the Soviet side continue to stress the German drive on Moscow as a more crucial conflict than the fighting in the south. In six sectors, the Nazis are said to be desperately attempting to close in on the capital without significant gains anywhere. It's stressed that the Germans haven't gotten any nearer to Rostov-on-the-Don than they were a week ago. And even in the Crimea, where the Russians admit the situation is extremely grave, the terrain is said to be increasingly difficult for the invaders. So much for the war in Russia as reported in dispatches to New York. Now for a report on the Russian war from London by Bob Trout, we turn to the British capital. Go ahead, London.
London hears that the fighting in Russia is apparently heaviest in the region west of Moscow and in the south. Russian spokesmen say that the Germans are being held, although they're throwing in reserves brought to the eastern front from the occupied country. In other words, we in London haven't heard very much from Russia today. Royal Air Force fighter planes attacked ground targets in northern France today, and the pilots who took part in these attacks described the German anti-aircraft fire from the soil of France as intense. One British pilot said the anti-aircraft fire was heavier than anything he had previously seen. The British have released some figures on the Royal Air Force offensive in the west. The Bomber Command, one of three commands, has dropped more than 10,000 tons of bombs on German-occupied territory in the past 3 months. And the British bomber effort last month is announced as nearly double British bombing in October of last year. This is the end of my second full day in London, and I still don't know just how the air raid sirens sound. It's been more than 3 months since London had a real raid. No one I meet seems to be particularly interested in speculating on when the siren will sound again. But I feel like the man in the story who waited all night for his noisy neighbor upstairs to drop the other shoe. If it would wail just once, if I only knew just how it sounds, I probably wouldn't be listening for it with one ear most of the time. There were some German planes over Britain tonight. Flight activity is reported over southwest England, and bombs were dropped in a coastal area, but there are no reports of casualties or of damage. London is very different, actually, from the photographs and the moving pictures of London at war. It's hard to tell you why. Perhaps it's just the general atmosphere, or perhaps it is just that intangible something that always makes the reality different from the make-believe. The only thing that looks entirely like the pictures is the screen of barrage balloons over the city. The newly arrived visitor looks at them to make sure that this is London, just as the sightseers stepping out of Washington's Union Station stand and stare a moment at the white dome of the Capitol. It's announced here that some of the German bombers now flying over Britain at night are equipped with fenders as a protection against the barrage balloons. These fenders are attached to the nose of the plane to cut through the cables of the balloons if the enemy planes are forced to fly low. The fenders are reported to weigh some 800 pounds of bombing loads carried. The Admiralty announces more British successes against enemy supply ships in the Mediterranean. Three more supply ships sunk, two of them in a convoy escorted by warships. I went to get my ration books today and got one booklet that most Londoners don't yet have. It's for canned foods, which are just beginning to be rationed here and will be controlled on the new point system, which you've already heard about, I know. I'm told that most of these canned foods, for which the new pink booklets are issued, are coming to us from the United States. I'll be able to tell you more about that after I've sampled my first can of baked beans or tuna fish. Can openers have not been rationed. I return you now to Columbia in New York.
From another part of the British Empire, Canada's Navy Minister disclosed today that German submarines are now operating within sight of the shores of Newfoundland, a bulwark in our hemisphere defense. Navy Minister MacDonald's statement was the first official confirmation in Canada that U-boats are so near the coast of this continent. Last night in Canada's Parliament, MacDonald revealed that Canadian warships have already sunk several enemy sea raiders. And when asked to amplify that statement today, the Navy Minister said, and I quote him, "There are submarines right off the coast of Newfoundland. They are actually within sight of shore. Naturally, we're attacking them whenever we can find them. So are the planes of the Air Force Coastal Command." That disclosure is quoted from Canadian Navy Minister MacDonald. Although Navy communiques are as cautious in Canada as they usually are in this country, MacDonald went on to reveal that two Nazi U-boats were attacked recently when discovered in Belle Isle Strait, where the northern mouth of the St. Lawrence River empties into the Atlantic. This is about 400 miles from the site of the United States Defense Base on the south coast of Newfoundland. One of the subs was engaged by a corvette, and the Canadians think they may have destroyed it. The other was attacked by a Canadian coastal patrol plane. MacDonald warned that there are many other U-boats now operating between Belle Isle Strait and Iceland, and still others along the southern route for convoys carrying American war supplies to Britain. Other news involving defense of this hemisphere was made in our own capital today. Albert Warner reports, we take you now to Washington.
A joint program of industrial production by the United States and Canada to outproduce Hitler was planned today. As an outgrowth of the weekend talk between President Roosevelt and Prime Minister King, a committee is set up to represent both countries. Milo Perkins, Executive Director of the Economic Defense Board, is chairman of the American group. Already, joint military action had been surveyed. Now, economic action. The Treasury already is moving for a new tax bill. House Ways and Means Committee members have been asked to hold hearings this fall on a bill to raise between $4 and $5 billion additional. Featuring the Treasury's new program is a still higher income tax to be deducted at the source in payroll levies. A presidential emergency board has recommended a settlement of the threatened railroad strike on the basis of compromise wage increases for over 1 million workers. Members of the five operating brotherhoods would get an increase of 7.5%, and the 14 non-operating labor unions would get 13.5%. The additional cost to the railroads would be $265 million a year, and the board hints that the burden might be shifted to the public through rate increases of 5%. The president makes a radio speech tomorrow at 3 p.m. as he gives a White House greeting to delegates of the International Labor Office. The White House regards it as an important address, slated to deal with labor and social questions. Navy Secretary Knox urges the arming of all American merchant ships. He emphasizes that submarines now hunt in packs. It's learned that they have attacked convoys from the surface. In the Senate fight over neutrality revision, isolationist Senator Wheeler talked for 5 hours today, warning against and a new expeditionary force. He gives his speech tomorrow. But the only woman member of the Senate, Hattie Carraway, demanded drastic revision of the Neutrality Act. She called that law a super appeal job, which invited attack. The final vote is not likely to be reached before Friday. Congressional leaders told the president that the House was ready to pass the Senate bill on Monday. Washington hears that the Japanese government is sending to this capital by Trans-Pacific Clipper a special envoy, former ambassador to Germany, Kurusu. The attitude of official Washington in the face of this development might be described as one of placid expectation, expectation of anything, or more likely, nothing. Secretary of State Hull said the new emissary would cooperate with the Japanese ambassador in a discussion with the State Department of Far Eastern issues. The implication from Tokyo is that Japan is tired of waiting, that it would like to force a prompt decision out of the protracted negotiations and a settlement on the basis of a free hand in Asia. There is official speculation whether this means a showdown. It depends on how much stock you take in the noise which comes out of Tokyo. There have been repeated periods when Tokyo's press and military swashbucklers have been saying, make an agreement or else. But I'm reminded that usually a man who is prepared to carry out the or else doesn't issue his warning more than once or twice. There's a feeling here that many in Japan appreciate the military risk of further aggression and also want to see how the war in Russia comes out. For more news on this subject, I return you now to New York.
As Mr. Warner told you, the reports from the Japanese capital on Suburo Kurusu's sudden and unexpected trip to the United States indicate that it's of vital importance. The China Clipper is being held 2 days at Hong Kong to make connection with the plane in which the special Japanese emissary is already on his way from Tokyo. Officially, the state of relations between the American and Japanese governments is called very serious. Beyond that, nothing official is said in Tokyo. Unofficially, the Japanese are indicating that Kurusu's trip is Japan's last effort to preserve peace in the Pacific. He's declared to be acting as the personal envoy of Japan's new premier and foreign minister and to be carrying final instructions on that government's attitude toward the United States. It's hinted he may be empowered to declare that if the United States wants to recognize Japan's claim of domination in East Asia, Japan will not go to war against this country, even if we become involved in war with Germany. Of course, there's another aspect to this highly publicized trip by Kurusu. Like everything the Japanese government and propaganda agencies have done lately, it's being dramatized. The sudden plane flight, the grave implications of the visitors built up in Tokyo. All this is propaganda of a sort, designed perhaps to impress Americans with an idea that Japan is in dead earnest about her efforts to reach a settlement of her difficulties with the United States. And that's the story of Japanese-American relations. Developments in the past 2 days have spotlighted growing friction between the British and Vichy government of Marshal Pétain. Yesterday, Vichy protested formally to London over the seizing of 5 French merchant ships on their way from Madagascar in the Indian Ocean to France. The British, who took the ships into port, charged they were carrying war contraband and were under German orders, and the British Admiralty asserted that such contraband trips had been continuous and Britain was determined to stop them. A Vichy announcement came back today with the charge that the British Navy has sunk or seized 800,000 tons of French shipping since the armistice was signed with Germany in June of last year, 200,000 tons alone since last May. And a few hours ago, Vichy put out another story, this time the charge that a British plane had landed 3 French parachutists on French soil, and another British plane had been captured on the ground in the same district. According to Vichy, the second plane was loaded with propaganda leaflets rallying Frenchmen to the cause of General de Gaulle, leader of the Free French. It stated the British crew of the plane is being held. This is the first mention from Vichy that parachute troops, either Free French or British, have been landed anywhere in France. Now as a postscript, the British Press Service in Washington announced tonight that 19 Americans en route to Britain for service in the Civilian Technical Corps of the RAF are missing from a ship which is presumed to have been sunk in the Atlantic. And that's the world today.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Hello there. Get ready to smile again with Radio's home folks, Vic and Sade. Vic and Sade, written by Paul Reimer, is brought to you each weekday by Procter & Gamble, the makers of the new Sure Mix Crisco.
Well, Nora, what are you doing in the kitchen at this hour?
Making an experiment.
Experiment?
Uh-huh. Remember that cake Ruth served at her party tonight?
Oh, yeah. Say, that was a swell cake, all right. That lemon filling was a honey. And as for that cake, boy, it was as light as a feather.
I know. And when I saw you on your third piece, I figured it was high time I found out how Ruth made her cake so light.
Oh, does she make them different than you do?
Yes. She uses a new kind of shortening. Sure Mix Crisco, she called it. And the Crisco people say it can give you lighter cakes than any other shortening they know of.
It's funny that shortening should make so much difference.
No, that's just what I thought. But Ruth said it's because Crisco is a different kind of shortening. It's made by an exclusive process that makes Crisco an active blender.
Active blender?
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Well, that's what I'm out here finding out. Ruth gave me some Crisco to take home, and she told me to put a tablespoon of Crisco in a glass like this,
mm-hmm.
and then to add a teaspoon of water and stir it a little.
Well, by golly, fat and water aren't supposed to mix, but that Crisco is taking the water right up.
Yes, folks, it's amazing, I know. But Crisco does take water right up, and Crisco does the same thing with your cake ingredients. Active blending means that Crisco helps your milk and your eggs and your flour mix together more completely than ever before. You'll get a smoother cake batter with Crisco than with any other shortening. A satin smooth cake batter that gives you lighter cakes. If you want lighter cakes, it's purely up to you. Crisco is waiting to give them to you. Make one of your favorite cakes. Use the same recipe, the same ingredients. Change nothing but your shortening. This time, use new Sure Mix Crisco. That cake can prove that Crisco gives you lighter cakes than any other shortening. Well, sir, the evening meal has been over only a little while, as I've seen opens now. And here in the living room of the small house halfway up in the next block, we find Mr. and Mrs. Victor Grope. Vic is established at the library table, competing with himself in a brisk game of solitaire. His wife sits nearby, ostensibly glancing through the newspaper. Actually, however, she's reading what's scribbled on a piece of scrap paper she just happened to spy beside her on the arm of the davenport. And of a sudden, she says in expostulating tones,
"No, Vic.
Beg pardon?
You're not going to send Christmas presents to all these fellas."
"All what fellas?"
"On this scrap of paper."
"That is a private scrap of paper."
"Well, it's laying here on the arm of the davenport, pretty public."
"I meant to throw it in the garbage bucket and forgot."
"No, but goodness. Goss Fuss, L. Wiley Pfaff, U. F. Beakley, T. W. Weatherwax, Howard S.
Some of those guys I'm going to send Christmas cards to."
"No, I'm reading the list marked gifts. You got one list marked cards and one list marked gifts. This is the one marked gifts."
"I feel that I'm quite capable of deciding to whom I wish to send Christmas presents. In fact,
I have the same rotten old argument every year."
"I know we do, and it's the most distressing thing. I had intended to handle my own Christmas giving this time and make no mention of the matter around home here. However, I slipped up. Before supper, I jotted down a bunch of names on that piece of scrap paper there and carelessly allowed it to come under your eye."
"Who's Gus Fuss?"
"A warm friend and a good scout."
"Never heard of him."
"He's with the Consolidated Kitchenware Company, Plant 17, Dubuque, Iowa."
"Hmm."
"I believe I pointed you out his picture on the cover of the last Kitchenware Dealer's Quarterly."
"Shirt sleeves?"
"What?"
"Fella in his shirt sleeves? Vest, but no coat? Earmuffs on his ears?"
"Yeah, that's Gus Fuss."
"Why should you have to send him a big, expensive Christmas present?"
"Is some mention made of big, expensive Christmas presents on that list?"
"We might as well shovel our money out the window with a coal scoop."
"I suggest you save your breath, Sadie. I'm determined that Gus Fuss will receive some slight token from his old pal Vic at Christmas time."
"Spend $5 or $6, hmm?"
"Very possibly."
"Well, let's draw our lovely money out of the savings bank and go throw it in the middle of Miller Park Lake."
"All right, let's do."
"Who's L. Willie Fapp?"
El Wiley Fat.
Who's he?
Another wonderful fellow from Plant 17, Dubuque, Iowa.
Is he a dear old darling chum of yours?
I feel that between El Wiley Fat and myself, there exists a firm bond of friendship. Yes.
Funny, I never heard of any of these beloved arms around the neck buddies.
I've mentioned El Wiley Fat on numerous occasions. I recall mentioning him just the other day. I was telling you and Rush about how he bought me a chocolate bar when I was in Dubuque.
He bought you a chocolate bar, so you feel like you have to trot out your pocketbook and get him a big, monstrous, expensive Christmas present.
Oh, kiddo, for Pete's sake.
No, but actually, every year in the world we go through the same business. You cook up a list of fellas a mile long to send gifts to. Why?
Please give me credit
Gus
for
having... $5 present. Nell Willie Yap, $5 present.
El Wiley Fat. El Wiley Fat
That's
is...
$10. My goodness, $10. All that's fondulix. Just because Jeff Mess bought you an ice cream cone.
Not just Mess, Sadie. Gus Fuss. And it wasn't an ice cream cone. It was a chocolate bar. And it wasn't Gus Fuss bought it for me. It was El Wiley Fat. Furthermore,
January,
I think
February, February, March, April,
I'm
May, June, July, August, September, October, November. We scrape and save and scrimp and accumulate money to put in the bank and are proud of ourselves. Then along comes December and something happens to your head and we take the bread out of our mouth to buy presents for all the fellas on this list. Oh, must be 20 fellas down here. And you're going to give them all $5 presents. Now, what's 5 times 20? 100?
What is when I went to school?
Think of it. $100. No, Vic, let's do that.
Do what?
Draw our money out of the savings bank and go throw it in the middle of Miller Park Lake.
I presume you have friends you intend to remember at Christmas time?
Just a teeny tiny rotten few. Robert and Laura Steen Price, Chuck and Dottie Brainfeeble, Bess and Walter, Fred and Ruthie, Mr. and Ms. Donahue, Uncle Fletcher and Miss Harris, you and Rush. That's about my list.
You're a housewife. I'm a businessman. Naturally, a businessman has many more obligations.
Oh, fiddly-whittle. Who's this U.F. Beakley?
U.F. Beakley happens to be the exalted Big Dipper of the Purple Prairie Popinjay chapter of the Sacred Stars of the Milky Way in Moline, Illinois.
A wild stranger.
The gentlemen whose names you see on that scrap of paper are not wild strangers. The gentlemen whose
names...
They're
wild strangers as far as I'm concerned. It's U.F. Beakley now. What you going to buy him for Christmas?
A gold watch and chain.
No.
U.F. Beakley gets a gold watch and chain. Gus Fuss gets a leather easy chair.
No.
El Wiley Fat gets a 16-cylinder automobile. T.W. Weatherwax gets a set of office furniture. Howard S. Montgomery gets a ruby ring. I. Edson Box gets a yacht. And Sam Shout gets a solid platinum coat hanger.
Ha, ha, ha.
Percy X. Snoot gets an emerald necktie clasp. For which I propose laying out $15,000 hard cash.
Very funny, ha ha ha.
Well, it's very funny, ha ha ha, this dimwit talk. I'm not going to buy all those guys $5 presents. You ought to know that.
How much are you going to spend?
Well, I can't tell. I haven't thought about it. 50 cents, maybe. 75. $1.25.
What kind of a gift can you get for 50 cents?
I don't know, say.
No, but what kind can you?
I don't know.
There's 20 names on this list.
Are there?
I counted them.
Mm-hmm.
Suppose you bought 20 50-cent presents. What would that add up to?
$10.
Well, we're not the kind of people, Vic, where $10 is grow on trees out in our front yard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We got to squeeze our $10 into a legal house.
Mm-hmm.
Can't you cut down on some of these names?
Sure.
You can?
Sure.
You're just saying that.
No.
You're just saying that so I'll quit talking.
No, you cut down the list yourself. Scratch out anybody you choose. Scratch out Gus Fuss. Scratch out El Wiley Fat. Scratch out Percy X. Snoop. Here's my pencil.
You'll just make out another list. Won't you?
Please, say.
Of course, you're doing your best to make me out stingy and mean. You know I'm not, though. You know, I'm only trying to...
Telephone's ringing.
All right, get it.
Mm-hmm.
Gus Fuss, L. Wiley Sapp, U.S. Beakley, T.W. Weatherwax, Howard S. Montgomery, I. Edson Box, Sam Shout.
Hello? Why, no, he's not. Down to YMCA, I believe. Well, I suppose, watching a fat man play handball. Who is this? Oh, hello, Rooster. How are you? Fine, thanks. Yeah, I think you'll find him there. Okay, Rooster. Mr. Davis, by George.
No, but what can you get for 50 cents?
Derby hat.
Seriously?
I don't know.
Can't get any very substantial Christmas gift for that little bit.
I'm just going to buy these fellas trifles, Dave.
Do you expect to receive Christmas presents from them?
Sure.
I don't remember you getting any 20 gifts from your business friends last year, or any year.
I got quite a few.
What did Russ Bus send you?
Russ Bus?
Yeah.
Sent me a necktie.
Where is it?
In Cody, Wyoming, under heavy guard.
I don't remember any necktie.
Oh, say.
No, but I don't.
Russ Bus, give me a necktie. Russ Bus, give me a necktie. Russ Bus, give me a necktie. Russ Bus, give me a necktie.
Funny, you can't tell me which one.
Russ Bus, give me a necktie.
What did Bill Willie Fitz send you?
Ed Wiley Fat?
Yeah.
Send me a necktie.
I don't recall you receiving any bushel baskets full of neckties last Christmas.
Ed Wiley Fat sent me a necktie.
U.F. Beakley send you a necktie also?
Yes.
What color was it, green?
Yes.
T.W. Weatherwax send you a necktie?
Yes. T.W. Weatherwax sent me a necktie.
Then Howard S. Montgomery and I. Edson Bach and Sam Schott and Percy X. Snood?
Yes.
Just refuse to discuss this with me.
It's all so wretched and pointless and miserable.
I'm only trying to do what any wife would do, Vic.
Thanks.
Well, I see places where your lovely salary can be economized down a little. Naturally, I do my best to track them down.
Mm-hmm.
January, February, March, April, May, June, July,
year.
August, September, October, November. We watch our pennies and save and scrimp and are real proud of our thriftiness. Then December comes along and you trot out your lead pencil and fix up Christmas lists with Moss Puss and Gel Billy Sap and T.W. Weatherwax and Sam.
Telephone's ringing, telephone's ringing, telephone's ringing.
Nice.
I bet it's good old Vernon Peggers. Mm. Or good old Roy Snow. Or good old Smelly Cat.
Yeah.
Maybe it's good old Leland Richards.
Could be good old Fred and Ruthie.
Hello? Oh, yes, it is.
Fred and Ruthie?
Yeah. How are you, Dr. Sleech? Oh, just sitting around with our shoelaces in our eyelets. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Well, sir, by George, Ruthie, I'll just go to work and see. It feels like 500.
All right.
Sadie hit the ceiling with ecstasy at the prospect, Ruthie. Fine. 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 Okay, Dandy. See you, Ruthie. Bye-bye.
Coming here, hmm?
Yep.
Right away?
Within the next half hour.
Hmm. Just fine. L. Willie Faff, U.F. Beakley, T.W. Weatherwax, Howard S. Montgomery.
Please, Sadie.
I. Edson Box, Sam Shout.
Please.
Percy X. Snoop.
Sadie.
What?
Please.
Which concludes another brief interlude at the small house halfway up in the next block. But don't forget to come along when we visit Dick and Sade the next time. This is Ed Hurley, he's speaking.
Washing, washing with the new Average Lakes. Oh, but they slick, they're double quick and just a trick for stockings. Wearing, wearing, oh, how your stockings wear. If you'll be bright and every night use double quick Average Lakes. Yes, sir, the important thing is don't let your stockings pile up. Why, if you'll just walk up to that wash bowl every night and swish your stockings through those pure ivory flake suds, well, believe me, it sure can be a lifesaver when it comes to longer stocking wear.
Why, it's amazing the wonderful wear women got when they tested many leading brands of silk stockings for us with new ivory flakes. For example, during a test with some beautiful Gotham gold striped stockings, women got 311 hours of wear. 319 hours, even as much as 340 hours of constant hard wear from a single pair of stockings. And when you think that silk stockings may soon be getting scarce, well, take the advice of experts. Remember, 9 out of 10 leading makers of famous stockings advise new double-quick ivory flakes for both their silks and their nylons.
So overnight, give hoes a dip. The night about, don't ever skip with those new ivory flakes.
My name is Henry Chop, your host, and we are counting down to World War II. We are spotlighting today, tonight, the week ending November 8th, 1941. If you follow us over on Patreon, you will be able to follow World War II day by day as the American public followed it. I told you before the previous two broadcasts aired what programs we were going to be featuring Sunday through Tuesday. Let me tell you what we're going to feature Wednesday through Saturday over on Patreon. Well, on Wednesday, we are going to spotlight November 12th, 1941, and we are going to have NBC News. And the news programs right now are becoming more important as America is getting really close to their involvement in the war. And then following the news, we have The Goldbergs, The Adventures of Superman, The Lone Ranger, two Fred Allen Texaco Star Theater programs, the East and West Coast versions of that, and sandwiched in between we have Romance of the Ranchos, a California regional program. Thursday, we spotlight November 13th, 1941, and we have more NBC News, The Goldbergs, a program called Saunders of the Circle X. Speaking of Liberty, a Baby Snooks sketch from the Maxwell House Coffee Time program. This is Wichita and Lum and Abner. And for Friday, it's November 14th, 1941, with The Goldbergs, The Adventures of Superman, The Lone Ranger, Lum and Abner, and Dark Fantasy, a horror program. Sorry, no information, please, on that Friday. I just don't have the recording for that. Oh, and we have some great stuff on Saturday for November 15th, 1941. Of course, it's Jungle Jim. We've been featuring that since we've been uploading starting in the year 1938. It's November 15th, 1941. Then we have the Knickerbocker Playhouse. And, of course, the Your Hit Parade jukebox. And then a three-hour-long NBC 15th anniversary program. And this is loaded with NBC's stars of the era. So some great stuff. That is worth the price of admission in just itself. 3 hours of great, great radio. So you're definitely going to want to check out our Patreon page. Subscribe. It's free. The link is in this description section. If not, look up Patreon on your laptop or your desktop. Put us in your smartphone. You can do that also. You have to create an account with a login, of course, just like Facebook or any other social media or even YouTube. Then you subscribe to the channel just like you would on YouTube. You subscribe to it. It's free. Then that'll unlock the old-time radio programs for World War II. Now, any out-of-era radio programs, well, except for the Christmas ones, I decided to make those a present to you guys for subscribing and, being loyal listeners. I decided to make those free this Christmas season. But anytime we do out-of-era radio programs, which I will be posting in earnest once January comes around for sure, simply because I'll have more time because I won't be cramming to post all these Christmas programs that I feature roughly about at least 5-6 hours a day of Christmas programming as we count up to Christmas. The link is in the description section to this video. And like I said, if you can't get there, just type in Patreon on your in your search engine and it should bring up the website. It's P-A-T-R-E-O-N, Patreon. Or go in your app store on your smartphone and you could find us there also. The name of our page is World War II on the Air and in Print, Old Time Radio and News. So if you look us up over there, you will find us. All right, let me tell you what we're going to listen to next. Well, our last program of the evening is a regional program called This is Wichita. It was based out of Kansas. This is number 48 in the series, and this aired on November 6, 1941. It's titled Buffalo Hunt.
Hello, world. This is Wichita. Wichita, its people, its progress. The story of your city and mine. This is Wichita. Listen to the sound of the buffalo stampede. Tonight, the Wichita Eagle brings you the story of one of the last big buffalo hunts near Wichita. In this day and age of airplanes and motor cars, it is difficult to realize that not so many years ago, just a little more than half a century, buffalo could be found in abundance near Wichita. But man's love of sport and in consideration of the future led to wholesale slaughter of the buffalo until today this beast has almost vanished from the earth. Tonight, the Wichita Eagle brings you the story of one of the last big buffalo hunts by early Wichitans. Now, before we lift the curtain on tonight's drama, the Eagle Concert Orchestra, under the direction of Russell Lowell, brings you the Gypsy Song from the opera Carmen by Bizet. Wichita Eagle believes in brief commercial announcements for its radio show, so we'll give you our message very briefly. Now, the Wichita Eagle is the first in the day and the first to pay in classified advertising. Place your ad where you can expect and will get results. Use Kansas' largest classified media, the Wichita Eagle, the newspaper that carries more classified advertising than any other newspaper in this state. And subscribe to the Morning and Evening Eagle. Only 20 cents per week brings you both the Morning and Evening Eagle and the huge Sunday edition. The Eagle, the newspaper for every member of your family. And now for tonight's story of This is Wichita. Let's go back to the small little town of Wichita in 1872. As our curtain rises, it is an unusually bright winter's day, the morning of December 21st, 1872. In the little town of Delano, now known as Wichita's West Side, a group of about 75 men have gathered for a big buffalo hunt. It is to be the last big buffalo roundup before the cold Kansas winter sets in. And so, with song and laughter, the adventurers rode toward the west, little dreaming that disaster was soon to meet them, and suffering was to be their only reward. Some of the wives and sweethearts tried to...
Jeb, I don't want you to go.
Now, Miranda, no sense in you acting up. We're,
Why, we'll be back for Christmas.
I don't care. There's no sense in you going. You was in on the last big hunt. Now you can just stay home and help me get ready for Christmas.
Oh, fiddle. I'm not going to do it. I'm going with the rest of the fellas.
You're no good, and well, we're due for a blizzard. What if you get stranded out there on them plains?
Oh, what if the moon falls down or the sun freezes up? Oh, you can think of more trouble.
No,
get yourself in the house. I'm off to hunt buffalo. Come on, get out.
Jeb! Come back, you old fool! Jeb! Oh, plague take a man anyhow.
You've got to listen to reason.
I'm not listening to anything you have to say.
But, Carol...
I don't want you to go on that old buffalo hunt, and you know it. Oh, hello, Mrs. Morgan.
Hello, Carol. I see you're having the same trouble with your man.
Oh, Miss Morgan, Carol doesn't understand. She doesn't want me to go on this hunting party.
Certainly don't. You just become engaged to me, and then you want to go out and hunt buffalo. What kind of a compliment is that?
Oh, Carol.
You find buffalo more entertaining than your wife-to-be.
Now, Carol, you know
I know none of you men have to go on this hunting party. No one in Wichita needs buffalo meat. Didn't you kill over 400 buffalo just less than a month ago?
He's right, lad. There ain't a man in that party needs to go out there.
Oh, you women don't understand. I'm not going for the fun of it. I'm going because I want to get plenty of buffalo hide. I need the money. Carol, honey, you're going to be my wife.
That's doubtful now.
Oh, Carol, don't talk like that. You'll change your mind when you see all the nice things I buy for you with them buffalo hides.
I wouldn't be interested.
Oh, Carol. You talk to her, Miss Morgan. Make her understand.
Not me. I'm on her side.
Oh, but Miss Morgan, if it don't go along, they'll think I got influenced by a woman.
And now wouldn't that be too bad? Oh, you men. Go on like my husband did. I said, don't go, and he said, goodbye, old woman, and rode off.
And that's what I got to do. Or I'll never catch up with him. Carol, honey, I'll be back. You'll understand. Oh, I love you, Carol. Goodbye. Goodbye, honey. Try to understand. I'll be back. Bye, Carol. Goodbye.
There he goes. Well, that just about leaves this town without a man.
Oh, Mrs. Morgan, why did he have to go?
Why did any of them have to go? My dear, you'll find that men just naturally have to be doing something active.
But wouldn't you think a man in love would be satisfied to stay at home with the one he loves?
It's easy to see you don't know much about these men. Give them a wild country to whip. Give them Indians to fight and hardships to endure. And they'll moan and complain about their lot. But they'll get the job done. They'll whip any wild country you put them in. They'll whip the Indians and batter down the hardships. And then as soon as they look around and can't see no trouble, they'll go out looking for
it. And forget the ones they love.
No, not forget them.
But that's what he does.
No, Barry's a good lad.
But I asked him not to go.
And I asked my husband not to go. But he went. That's no sign he don't love
Enough
me.
Enough sign for me. See that handsome gentleman coming across the street?
Where? Oh, gracious child. That's one of them no-good gamblers from Keno Corner.
I think he'll be very happy to learn that Barry prefers buffalo hunting to me.
Now, Carol, don't be getting any foolish ideas in your head. Oh, you can't be caring for that no-good gambler.
No, but you haven't met
him. And I don't want to. I've heard about him. You come on with me. We've got to fix some decorations for the church.
Howdy, Miss Carol. How are you? Anyway, nice morning, isn't it?
Yes,
nice,
isn't it?
Morning.
Oh, Mr. Dillard, have you met Mrs. Moore?
Oh, I know
no,
I
you
have.
You needn't bother to introduce me. Heard about you, Curly Dar.
Well, thank
and
you.
It's a pity to me the men of this town aren't shooting you instead of them poor buffaloes that never harmed anyone.
I take it you don't like me.
And you take it right. Come on, Carol. Come along with
me. No, thanks, Mrs. Morgan. I think I'll talk to Carol.
That's the stuff, Carol.
Oh, no. A certain young man who's out hunting buffalo will be sorry.
So, he left you for a buffalo. Well, you little heartbreaker, it serves you right.
Surely I don't see anything so funny about
it. Oh, you don't? Well, that's because you're not looking at it from my point of view. Let me see your fingers.
My fingers? Why?
Come on, hold out your hand. Uh-huh. I thought you were supposed to be engaged to him.
Well, I am.
Then where's the ring?
Well,
he didn't give you one.
Well, no, but I really didn't mind that.
Hey, if you were engaged to me, you know what I'd do?
What?
I'd put the biggest, most sparkling diamond you ever saw in your life right on that finger.
I guess I've never seen that many diamonds.
Sure you haven't. That's a knick-knack.
Barry's the only one I ever got engaged to.
Sure, and what'd you get? Nothing. Close your eyes.
What for?
Never mind, just close them.
No, I think I'll keep them open with you around.
Why?
I just think I'd better.
Afraid of me, huh?
Oh, Curly, you're really an awfully nice gentleman at times. I mean, you talk nice and you look nice.
But I work on Kino Corner. I'm a gambler.
Well, it's a pretty bad way to make your living, you've got to admit.
Well, I'll take it any day to work in soil or hunting buffalo or driving a stagecoach. Listen, Carol, how'd you like to wear some really nice clothes? Something all shiny with spangles and jewels on them.
You mean like the dance hall girls wear at Rowdy Joe's?
No, I mean like them big high-class society dames wear. The kind of women you don't even see out in this little cow town.
What's wrong with the women here?
Yeah, they're all sunburned, windburned. Look at old Lady Morgan. You get to look like that someday. Listen, Carol, you're a swell-looking kid. You're young and you're pretty. What do you want to get tied down with a guy like Barry?
Oh, Curly,
come on, close your eyes. Hold them for just a minute and hold out your hand.
What?
Come on.
All right.
Yeah, that's... There. Just fits that engagement finger. Open your eyes. Take a look.
Oh, Curly. Oh, it's just beautiful.
Sure it is. I won that from a customer last night.
Boy, is it real?
Sure it's real.
But it's so big.
I'll weight you down with diamonds if you'll say the word.
Oh, Curly,
can't you understand what I'm trying to offer you? Now, forget all this stuff about getting a home started out on the prairie. Forget what a few of these old hens tell you about me. I'll show you the kind of life you really ought to lead.
You've got to let me think about
this. Sure. How about making up your mind before Christmas?
Well, that's not far off.
You see, I kind of want you for a Christmas present. I tell you what. Come on over to Rowdy Joe's tonight, and we'll sit at the table and talk it over.
Oh, I can't go there.
Of course you can. Listen, don't let those old women in the town scare you out. Nobody's going to hurt you over at Rowdy Joe's. I'll be there.
Well, I don't
I'll be waiting for you tonight.
Harold, you can't do it. Don't be a fool, Charlie. He's no good, I tell you.
But, Mrs. Morgan, it won't hurt to see him.
Won't hurt to see him. Listen, child. You'll throw away all your own self-respect. You're engaged to Barry.
He doesn't think enough of me to stay home from that silly buffalo hunt.
Oh, such talk. Maybe Barry's telling the truth. Maybe he needs them hides, needs them for money. Just because most of them men went out for fun's no sign Barry did.
But maybe Curly's wrong.
Right about what?
Maybe there is something more to life than just working for a home and some land and not having any nice things.
So that's his talk to you.
Well,
nothing. If your love for Barry's no stronger than that, then it's good riddance for
you. But I haven't said I was...
What are you looking at? That ring. There on your finger.
Oh.
Curly gave you that?
Yes, he put it on my finger this afternoon.
And you kept it on.
Well, yes, of course I did. I like it. It's beautiful. Oh, I've never had anything as nice as that.
Did he tell you how he got it?
Yes, he said some customer lost it in a poker game.
Playing poker?
Well, what is it?
So you think it's a beautiful ring, do you?
Of course I do. Oh, it's thrilling just to look at it sparkle on my finger. Oh, Mrs. Morgan, can't you understand that?
Yes. I can understand it very well.
Why are you crying?
Well, my dear, it's sort of a mixture between feeling sorry for myself and wanting to split my husband's head with a single tree. That ring happens to belong to me.
To you?
Yeah. I never wear it. Too pretty to wear and do the hard work I have to do, but Jeb gave me that ring. You can see my name engraved on the inside of it. It's the only nice thing Jeb ever gave me.
But how did Curly... You mean your husband?
Yes, Jeb likes to gamble and raise Cain, and he gets short of money sometimes. But that's the first time he ever stole my ring. My engagement ring.
And if I weren't so hurt, I'd get on a horse and ride out and shake Jeb's teeth out, the old devil. This is just about the meanest thing Jeb ever done. Wait till he gets back from that buffalo hunt.
Here's your ring, Morgan.
Oh, that's sweet of you. Now have you kind of changed your mind about that no good gambler?
No, I haven't changed it. I just made it up.
You mean that you're not...
Yes, I'm going to see Curly. I can see Barry doing something just like your husband in a few years. You work for them and work with them, and you get nothing but gnarled, ugly hands and wrinkles. I'm going to get plenty of diamonds.
Harold!
Oh, you gave the old lady back her ring.
Yes.
Huh?
Well, I don't see how her husband could do that.
Now, that's your nice, respectable, hard-working, home-building husband for you, kid. Wait a minute. I'm going to calm down that music. I'll close it.
I feel sort of strange here. So this is Roddy Joe's wild dance hall.
This is it. The den of iniquity. Let's drink to it.
No, I don't want to. I don't drink.
Hey, you got to learn, kid.
I want to think. Talk to me, Curly. Let me think all of this is right.
Sure. Sure, I'll talk to you. Come on over here and sit on my lap, honey.
Come on.
Over here. Come on, Curly.
That's the way. Do you really love me?
Well, sure.
But you say that so easily. Yeah. You just shrug your shoulders and say it.
Yeah? How's Barry say it?
Like he means it.
Sure, all those farmers are alike. You want to forget them, kid. You're going to have more fun, and you're going to have more life around here than you ever dreamed of.
Sir,
yes,
it's getting kind of cold out, don't you think?
Sure, a regular blizzard's coming up.
Blizzard?
Yeah, it's going to go way down below zero.
Zero?
Sure. What are you worried about? It's always plenty warm around here, right around here.
I wouldn't look out of the window. Let me out.
All right, go on. The old snow's sure falling fast.
Listen to that wind.
Yeah, I sure wouldn't want to be out there with that hunting party.
Do you think they'll get caught?
How can they miss it? They didn't figure on a blizzard when they left here, the poor fools.
Oh, but surely they'll get back. Surely they will, won't they?
How should I know? Who cares?
But he's out there. Oh, Curly, that would be terrible.
No, that wouldn't be so bad. I feel pretty good.
Oh.
What's the matter? Hey, come back here. Where are you going?
I don't know, but I'm not going to stay here.
Hey, wait a minute. What's the idea?
Let go of me, Curly. I don't love you. I can't love you. I get it still, Barry.
Barry.
And Holly out there, knowing he's out there. Knowing he might be something. Well, I've got to go.
Listen, you little fool. Who do you think you are? What do you think I am? You can't throw me over just like that.
Curly, I don't love you.
So you don't love me. What's that got to do with it? Maybe you'll learn.
No, I won't.
Hello,
I want to get away from here. I don't want to see you laughing about Barry getting stuck out there in that blizzard.
Listen, you can't help him now. That party's miles away from here. They're stuck out there. Now forget about him. I'm going to talk some sense to you, kid.
Let go of me, Curly, please.
I'm not going to talk any sense to you. I'll make you forget that dumb buffalo chaser. I'll make you forget everything.
Curly, don't scream.
Go ahead and scream. Who's going to hear you?
I am.
Not with us. Who?
Let go of her.
Hey, you.
Oh, Mrs. Morgan.
Listen, what are you doing here?
Never mind. Now let her out of here.
Why, you old fool.
Don't make a move or there'll be another shooting at Rowdy Joe's. And you'll be full of holes. Come on, Carol. It's a good thing I followed you here, you little fool.
Mrs. Morgan, you're wonderful. But what about the blizzard? What about our men?
Now, there's nothing we can do, child, but wait. Wait and hope.
They'll all die. They'll be frozen stiff.
And you'd like that, wouldn't
sure,
you?
Sure, why not?
Well, if you like it so well, you can just try some of it. Take off your pants.
What?
You heard me. Take them off.
Why, what are you talking about? I'll see you.
No, you won't. I'm not going there. Take them off. Turn your head, Carol. Come
now,
on,
wait a
you.
Minute.
I
you
mean
can't.
What I say.
Why, you
you're
going to
peel that blizzard, you lizard.
Well, listen, you can't do this to me. I'll freeze out there.
And now, won't that be too bad?
Now, wait a minute.
I'm counting three.
Oh, no,
and
now.
And if you're not out of them pants,
hey,
I'll shoot them off.
Now, wait.
One, two.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. I'll do what you say.
Hurry up.
All right.
In out of them.
Right, hi. I'm out of them. I'll get you for this.
That blizzard.
No, wait a minute.
Go on. I've been praying for it.
Listen, I'll freeze up.
Come on.
Come on. Come on.
Come on.
Throw another log on that fire, Carol. It's kind of getting low.
Mrs. Morgan, do you think there's any hope at all?
That's all we've got is just hope.
For 2 days now that blizzard's been going on. What will they do?
Oh, they'll fight to get back. Poor wretches. They were so sure it wouldn't turn off cold.
But it was so beautiful when they left. It's just like an early fall day.
That's Kansas for you. Quick change of weather. I was afraid of something like this. Why, I didn't want Jeb to go.
You've forgotten all about being angry with him, haven't you?
Yeah, and that all went away when I heard that wind howling out there and got to thinking of him being caught out in it.
That's the way it happened to me. I guess I really didn't know much about love. Guess you almost lose it before you find it. Oh, if there were only something we could do. Something we could do for them. Just a little bit of this warm fire. Just some of that coffee. When I think of them out there...
Now, don't let yourself go to pieces.
But if they haven't come back after this long, what's it like when you're frozen to death?
Listen.
What is it? Oh, yeah, it's them. Oh, they haven't got
back. They're kind of out. Look, you can see them staggering down.
Oh, look, they're back.
Oh, they got back.
Oh, man.
They got back. Hot coffee and some more of this soup.
Oh, Mirandy, you don't know how sorry I am.
Yes, I do, too.
You don't know all the things I thought of while I was fighting to get back.
That's all right.
But we all made it, every one of us. Mirandy, we're all back in time for Christmas.
Ain't that good?
Mirandy, I think buffalo hunting's going to be a thing of the past.
Yeah?
But they're getting too scarce. Gotta go too far out to get them. Mirandy.
Yes, Jeff?
What do you think of all the time I was gone?
Something I got on my hand.
On your hand?
Yes, this ring.
Oh.
And as soon as you get well, we'll talk about
now,
that.
Now, Mirandy.
Shut up. We're going to church for Christmas Eve and a wedding.
And so our curtain falls on memories of one of the last big buffalo hunts for the good citizens of Wichita. Memories of Christmas Eve, 1872. Every Thursday evening, the Wichita Eagle opens its rich storehouse of memories and brings you a story of your city and mine. This program was produced in the new KFH studios in the York Ride Building. The Eagle cordially invites you to listen again next Thursday to another drama of This is Wichita.
And that's the way it was, the week ending November 8th, 1941. My name is Henry Chop, your host, and come back again next Saturday night, same time, same station, as we spotlight the week ending November 15th, 1941. And next week, well, we have a lot of news stuff, news programs. We are going to feature the Armistice Day programs. We have Secretary of the Navy Frank Knox, President Franklin D. Roosevelt, a news program from NBC, and a horror program also from NBC. So we're staying on NBC all week. It's a dark fantasy. And once again, check out the link in the description section for our Patreon page. You'll enjoy the radio programs we feature there as well as the newspaper. My name is Henry Chop, your host. Until next week, good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times, we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.